Good afternoon.
My name is Pat Howell, the director of the bottom wards here in West Point. And there's a saying that it's better to be lucky than to be good, because what occurred on Saturday regarding Afghanistan. There's reason. So I like to say that we planned this so rapidly that we had it set up in a day and a half, but we scientifically picked this day about 2 months ago by throwing a dart against the wall. So we were lucky in that particular case. So I'd like to welcome you to the Modern War Institute's War Council on Reconstruction. Now, for those of you who this is your first time, the purpose of the War Council is not to come to a conclusion, not to walk away saying, aha, I have the answer. The idea is to take a topic that folks don't know a lot about, expose you to 3 or 4 different perspectives from either different disciplines or from different organizations, and just get a chance to learn a little bit about the topic from a multidisciplinary point of view, and then for you to ask questions, and so you walk away smarter on this question, on this topic. So this War Council is unique for 2 main reasons. First off, we've never covered a topic like Reconstruction before. Our last War Council was on U.S.-Iranian relations right after the drone strike in Soleimani. So Reconstruction is a little bit odd. And the second thing that makes this War Council unique is the fact that we didn't come up with the idea. It was actually a group of cadets that were interested in Reconstruction and the economic side of this. That's what got this idea going. It was actually debt-driven. There's an interest on this topic. So while this topic might be unusual, it's definitely not irrelevant. And the reason why is because the doctrinal change that the Army is going through now as we're moving to multi-domain operations, MDO explicitly calls on the Army to work with the rest of the Joint Force in doing reconstruction after combat operations in order to solidify our lock-in and strategic objectives. So unusual topic for war councils, but extremely relevant to the Army's plan on fighting in the future. However, donning us back to Afghanistan, as described in the Washington Post Afghanistan Papers, after nearly 2 decades of war, the Joint Force's ability to consolidate gains and establish regional security through Reconstruction has come under a lot of congressional scrutiny and congressional media scrutiny. Now, to help illuminate the topic of Reconstruction for the group here, we brought in three different perspectives from your left to right. Kneeling to my left is Craig Collier from the Office of the Special Inspector General for Afghanistan Reconstruction. Next to him is Mrs. Annette Evans from the United States Army Corps of Engineers. And then lastly is Major Duncan Walker from the Department of Social Sciences. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give a quick bio for each of our speakers, and then I'm going to hand it over to them. They're going to have some opening remarks for 8 or so minutes. I might follow up with 1 or 2 specific narrow questions, but really then we're going to hand it over to you all. You all are what actually makes these sort of forums good. So the question that you got burning in your head, if you don't have one now, hopefully listening to our 3 speakers will help generate an idea for you. So first off, for Mr. Craig Collier. Craig Collier graduated from West Point in the class of 1986 and was commissioned in the infantry. He served for over 26 years in a variety of command staff positions with multiple assignments. He is deployed to Panama for Operation Just Cause, Macedonia for Operation Able Century, East Timor for Operation Stabilize, and twice to Iraq, once as a deputy brigade commander and once as a squadron commander. Since retiring from the Army in 2011, he has worked as the senior advisor for the Special Inspector General for Iraq Reconstruction, the senior director for planning for the American Red Cross Disaster Cycle Services, and as the readiness staff lead for the House Armed Services Committee. He currently works as the senior analyst for the Special Inspector General for Afghan Reconstruction. Today, he will be discussing the latest special report from CGAR entitled The Human Cost of Reconstruction. Next to Craig is Mrs. Annette Evans. Mrs. Evans was most recently deployed as the Deputy District Engineer for Programs and Project Management in the Afghan District of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. So she just left country in December. So she just finished a 12-month tour overseas in Boston now and just freshly back home. As the District Senior Civilian Advisor to the District Engineer, Ms. Evans led the $1 billion construction and contracting program in a team of 130 Corps of Engineer professionals, delivering 85 critical host station projects dealing with a variety of infrastructure, road construction, electrification, and various advisory projects. Last, but definitely not least, because we have been on the heels of friendly strike together playing Ultimate Frisbee, is Major Duncan Walker. Duncan graduated from West Point in the class of 2008 and was commissioned in the infantry. He previously served as platoon leader in Company XO in the 101st Airborne Division, and a company commanding the 1st Cav Division. He received a master's in public policy from Georgetown's Court School of Public Policy prior to arriving at West Point in 2017. He now serves as the Department of Social Science as an assistant professor of economics. His research analyzes the efficacy of military aid spending on conflict reduction. Today, he will be discussing the economic aspects of Reconstruction and lessons learned from economic development from interventions across the globe. With that, please welcome our speakers.
Colonel Howell, thank you.
Get a perfect angle, make a loop.
All right, how's that?
Better.
All right, that one works.
All right, I got you now? Okay, thanks. My name's Craig Collier. I work as a senior analyst for the Special Inspector General for Afghan Reconstruction. So thank you, Colonel Howell, for having me here. So what I'm here to talk about today is a recent report that we just put out called The Human Cost of Reconstruction. The reason we decided to do a special project on this is because SIGAR, as it's known, has done hundreds of different projects and audits looking at reconstruction in Afghanistan. Trying to measure what we got out of our $136 billion to date appropriated reconstruction effort for Afghanistan. We've never really taken a look at what the other tool is. When we talk about blood and treasure, this is the kind of blood. So what was the human cost of what we did? When we're talking about reconstruction, it doesn't just mean physical buildings or other things. There's really no set definition of what constitutes reconstruction. I use the definition primarily that we got from our charter. SIGAR was chartered by Congress in 2008, the National Defense Authorization Act, and that includes not just brick and mortar buildings, but also things that we do to establish the political, societal underpinnings of a country. So that includes, particularly for you cadets, that would be trying to upgrade, train, and equip the Afghan National Defense and Security Forces. And we lost quite a few soldiers doing that. I'll get into that. We used a variety of sources. Probably the best thing was the Army. They had every death requires a 15-6, that is an investigation under Army Regulation 15-6, formal investigation. A lot of these you don't find. The Army and DOD in general does not define the instruction. It's either you're killed or you die. They'll give you in the guide of combat or accident or natural causes or suicide or homicide. They don't differentiate between combat and reconstruction. All right, with that, got a few slides here. Okay, this is by the numbers. These casualties, that includes killed and wounded. Quite a few, over 5,000. A couple things I want to point out about this. One is, you notice who's taking the bulk of the casualties and the kidnappings. It should come as no surprise that the Afghans take the bulk of that. And we divided that up into the different categories. You can see Army American civilians and American military members. This includes green on blue. We found that doing reconstruction, that would include the people who were at SFABs, police mentoring teams, etc. There were 59 killed doing that, and what we found, 49 wounded. Now, what do you notice about the number of wounded? What does that number seem? Low, high? Normally, you'd expect that number to be about 3 to 5 or more times the number of killed. But wounded don't generate a lot of information. So I suspect that the number of wounded is significantly higher than that. We just couldn't find it. When we did this report, we have to be able to justify auditing, basically auditing standards. I have to be able to defend every one of these numbers. So I need some type of information. Yes, this guy died of reconstruction. So I think you can look at this as a floor of the number that were killed. By the way, this was from April 17th of 2002, when President gave a speech at BMI where he announced the plan of reconstruction. When we took that to the end of 2018, we needed a stopping point. This took over a year. So that's roughly about 12%, which is interesting because it was part of another project in Iraq. measuring the human cost there, and reconstruction is about 4% down. Give the next slide. We also looked at the different activities that were being done. You can see that of all of them, if you look at the key road construction, was the most dangerous activity, particularly for Afghans. I know the Corps was involved heavily in that. The most dangerous activity for service members was recreating the AMDSM. The two most devastating attacks actually were road construction. Both of them involved over 20. One was a V6 project, another one was another American funded project. We couldn't figure out where it came from. But one of them, there was 35 killed, 20 wounded, and another one, 28 killed, 35 wounded. So these were pretty substantial attacks on road construction activities. Another event in governance was a fairly notorious within some Army circles, but that was book delivery mission in Sabah province in 2013, April 2013, where three soldiers were killed, eight wounded, an additional eight Afghans were wounded. State Department woman lost her life as well as her injury. And again, the report goes into much more detail about all of these. You also looked at by year. One of the things I'd like to, it should come as no surprise that the bulk of the casualties occurred during the surge period between 2009 and 2011. If you notice in orange there, that's election activities. That does not include Afghans running for office. That includes just people trying to work the election, work the polls, etc. And you can see, I think it's 04, 10, and 18, I believe it is. You can see it was 14. So there's a lot of casualties. All right, so why is this important? Why is this important to us to try and measure the human cost of reconstruction? I'll give you three reasons. First, for you cadets, when you're out there, you need to have some situational awareness of what's going on. And I don't just mean what's going on in your area right now, but you need to look, if you were deployed to Afghanistan or any other theater and you're not the first one in, there's a lot of other agencies that are doing things out there that you're not really fully aware of, or may not be fully aware of. Corps out there doing things, USA, Department of State, other countries are funding projects. You need to understand a little bit of the history. So that village sheikh that we're talking to may not be really interested in helping Americans, not because he necessarily hates you or dislikes you, but he sees the patch on your right shoulder and knows that Americans may have funded a road construction project 3 years ago, and happens the military trails, the village were wiped out when they were attacked. May have nothing to do with you or the military, but he sees you as a representative. Another one is tactics. If you know that a road construction project is going into your area, and the bad guys tend to focus on those on projects that are coming in, you can kind of use that to your advantage and watch out for the enemy and increase your surveillance and whatever you're going to do to protect those guys. It becomes kind of a twofer. You protect the American investment, protect the locals you're trying to help, and you get to go and eliminate some bad guys. But finally, this brings my last slide. You sometimes hear that reconstruction is not lethal, or that it's a soft mission. It's not. These are the people, these are the five that I mentioned that were killed in that book donation project. Now, a lot of things you guys do, and you're going to do, especially as platoon leaders and lieutenants. You're not going to have much of a say in some of these operations, but you look at some of these missions and were they worth it? And I'm not sure this mission was worth it. It was worth the lives of these people and those who were injured. So don't think that because you're going on some type of reconstruction mission, you're going to a grand opening of a building or a school or anything like that, the bad guys don't think that they can take advantage of that. And reconstruction mission should be treated like any other kind of mission. And with that,
good afternoon. Colonel Howell, thank you for having me here and representing U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. So it's great to be here and participate in the discussion about reconstruction. I must say I'm a little bit surprised that Colonel Howell I think you mentioned, this is really the first time this subject has been brought up as part of a forum like this at our nation's premier academy, in my opinion. That strikes me for a couple of reasons, in that we've been doing, I'm saying we, U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, but others, as Craig mentioned, in Afghanistan for almost 20 years. So in my opinion, any discussion that we should have or keep having about reconstruction could have started a couple of decades ago, quite frankly. And I think to Craig's point, maybe we would have done some things differently and maybe not, but I think the point of this forum today and why I really appreciate being here is to continue the conversation. You will hear, I think, people say, we'll never do, as the United States government, we'll never do anymore what we have tried to do in Afghanistan. Some people call it nation building, some people call it stability ops, the variety of monikers. I actually disagree with that. I think that there will be a time in the future that we're going to have this conversation about how reconstruction supports military Department of Defense efforts. And if we don't take the time today to learn about and to consider, especially in light of Craig's report, what it costs to do that, we're going to miss the mark. When you guys go to your battles that you will fight in your Army careers and your DoD careers, don't be afraid of this conversation, because I think it will happen again. I want to talk just briefly about what the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers is. I won't go into a long mission, but it's really critical to the questions that I'll pose to you at the conclusion of my intro today. The Corps of Engineers is an executing agency on behalf of the United States government. It's a reimbursable agency, meaning that the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, I'm going to use the term USAIS, doesn't do work unless somebody else pays us to do the work. There are a few exceptions, but the first thing you'll have to deal with in your career is a reimbursable government agency isn't bad, we're not evil. It's the way that Congress set USAIS up. We sometimes go by the name of USACE. That does get us in a little bit of trouble. We're good to hear that, and especially downrange. For a couple of reasons, expensive and slow. There is that too. But there's a lot of good that USAIS does, and I'm not here to talk about USAIS, but I want you to think about why our government would create an agency, a reimbursable agency, to build roads and hospitals and clinics and power plants and schools and wind farms and all the infrastructure that is required for the Afghan National Defense Security Forces. Why would our government choose to do that? And you can ponder that for just a few minutes. USAIS, at the behest of the U.S. government, went into Afghanistan in 2002 as part of engineer support team. That's very normal. Usually civilians, often active duty, attach themselves to units that go to war. And that's not unusual. And that happened in 2001. I'm just going to read a little bit of my, and I don't want to get the dates wrong, so I'm going to refer to my notes. In September 2002, USAIS assisted to begin setting up the Afghan National Army's infrastructure program as requested by the Office of Military Cooperation. We let our first contracts by the end of 2002, and then as time moved along, the U.S. government Department of Defense decided that USAIS needed to help with all the infrastructure inside the wire. So inside our bases, like Bagram Air Force Base, New Kabul Compound, the International Airport, et cetera. And in March 04, the first district was set up, which is really it's an execution arm of USAIS headquarters, making sure that we scoped and engineered projects as well as oversaw them through construction. In August 09, a second district was established in Kandahar. And then in 2013, we pulled it back into one district based on the workload. I've been deployed 3 times to Afghanistan, 10-11 during the surge. I was in Kandahar working with USAIS, again in 13-14 for joint engineers on the U.S. War Aid side. We'll call that the customer side. And then again, my most recent deployment. So about 10 years of my life, I've spent wondering if this is all worth it. And so I just want to show you a slide. I'm not here to answer that question, but you can answer that for yourself, and our panel can. I just want to show you this slide here that I hope will elicit some questions in your mind about, is it worth it? Why would we do this in the beginning? What's in it for the host nation? What's in it for foreign policy? What's in it for the Department of Defense? So you can see that the three lines of effort that are listed up there, those are the district's current lines of effort. The first line of effort is to focus on the infrastructure necessary to build a stable Afghan defense security forces, both police and army. They need installations just like we do. So we the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, focuses on helping them to build those installations. The second line of effort emerged actually during my first deployment, which was to build the national electrical infrastructure for the entire country. So we're talking about everything outside of the U.S. military and NATO wire, but also an electrical infrastructure that connects those ANDSF bases to the national grid. So that is one of USAIS's job and has been since 2010. And the third line of effort has to do with helping to support coalition platforms, specifically now for special forces, making sure that they have good platforms in which to do their operations throughout the country. Those three lines of effort are what I would brief you if I were briefing you as an introduction to the district. What I think for this venue is very, very interesting is all that surrounds those three line of efforts. You probably see the word strategy up there multiple times. You probably see, I don't really have my glasses so I can't see, but you probably see things like doctrine maybe, or support to the CENTCOM AOR. So the question I think that we need to ask ourselves is, if USAIS is an executing agency, we don't go build anything on our own unless someone asks us to, right? And gives us the money to do it. I think we can ask ourselves several questions, and you can as you develop your Army careers. Should the military be involved in reconstruction? And if so, who makes that decision, and what kind of reconstruction should it be? And then to what end? If the military is not involved in reconstruction, like the three lines of effort that you see up there, who should do it, if anyone, and what will happen if you don't do it? And then the third question is, if you all, as commanders and leaders in units, if you decide to do it, when do you stop it? What is the right time? And if you do stop, who do you hand it to if it's not done? Or who you hand it off to, even if it is done. We're talking about the reconstruction, the infrastructure effort itself. And so I think as we go along and listen to what economic development has to do with reconstruction, and we think about the types of money that Department of Defense and our U.S. government uses to fund reconstruction, as military officers, you cannot divorce yourself from these questions. I do believe it will come up again, and I appreciate the opportunity to contribute to the conversation about it.
Thank you so much again, sir, for having me as part of this panel as well. I'd like to begin with a quote. I'd like to begin with a quote from General George C. Marshall in a speech he delivered as the Secretary of State at Harvard University on June 5th, 1947. It is logical that the United States would do whatever it is available to do to assist in the return of normal economic health in the world, without which there can be no political stability and no assured peace. Our policy is directed not against any country or doctrine, but against hunger, poverty, desperation, and chaos. Its purpose should be the revival of a working economy in the world so as to permit the emergence of political and social conditions in which free institutions can exist. Marshall goes on to prescribe that any such program designed to restore a country's economy cannot be made unilateral, and that the initiative must come from the host nation. Critical to the success of any economic development plan is the complete understanding of the problem and the solutions to be applied, which may only come from cooperation with the country to be developed. Marshall provides us with two key insights then. The first is that economic interventions are critical as a component to the reconstruction effort, and in terms of sequencing, perhaps they provide the necessary condition in which political stability and eventually peace will grow. There is a certain feel reminiscent to Maslow's hierarchy of needs: safety, hunger, shelter. The most basic must come before the most complex. The second key takeaway is one that we are rediscovering in economics today. and that is that a full understanding of the problem can only come from a bottom-up approach. Interventions do not happen to people, interventions happen with people. So how exactly does one create policy that energizes an economy post-conflict? What are the important institutions? And of course, how does one sequence these so that we are not pulling the complex and putting them before the simple? I offer you today a three-phase paradigm for addressing the economic aspects of reconstruction. Phase one, humanitarian relief. Phase two, the restoration and creation of services. And phase three, the restoration or creation of a free market economic institutional system. These three phases operate on the continuum of microeconomics to macroeconomics and target three distinct goals: stability, economic development, and economic growth. I'd like to harp on that, but those are not the three same goals. Those are three distinct and different goals. Humanitarian relief is a microintervention. As such, it is significantly easier to assess empirically, and the evidence is stronger for its efficacy. The goal of this phase is to perpetuate stability and keep the reconstruction in a post-conflict state. It quickly garners support from the populace and is valued highly on a relevant, on the relative scale as an immediate need, and it helps to co-opt the local populace for future interventions. Phase two, the restoration and creation of services, bridges the gap between micro and macro and can occur on a variety of scales. Again, the smallest of these is the best understood, and their primary role is to create conditions for economic development. Interventions in healthcare, education, and microfinance are some of the areas that contribute to meaningful economic development. The final phase is the creation of free market economic institutions like private property, patent law, credit markets, and a stable currency. Unfortunately, the causal links between these larger macroeconomic questions and development outcomes are very difficult to assess. In fact, this major contrast between aid effects at the micro or project level and the macro country level is the root cause of the friction between some of our best economists, Sachs, Easterly, and the others. Today, I look forward to representing the economic perspective with you as we continue to discuss post-conflict reconstruction.
Thank you all. I'm going to introduce them. I have posed one short question to each of the panelists, just one thing I think they might have trouble highlighting, and then we'll turn over to you all to ask questions. So first off, let's ask all three, and then you can go ahead and answer. Craig, I apologize if I might have missed this one, but if you could go into, if there's a ratio between casualties and reconstruction versus normal combat arms, and then how that stacks historically, if Afghanistan and Iraq were in line with historical norms, or is this an aberration one way or the other? And that one thing you should clarify, you talked about as you say, as a reimbursable agency, who is doing your work? What different labor pools, and what are the challenges associated with those different options on doing the work in these sites? And lastly, for Duncan, given that your opening partner, that the opening statement you had from George Marshall, where the host nation needs to sort of define what the requirements are, did it look like, did we try to overdevelop Afghanistan past what it should be? If we have a very sort of third world country, do we try to develop it into a second or first world when really its capacity should be back to where it was?
Okay, so for that first question, historically, really, the only thing we've got is really Iraq. And I mentioned before, when we look at the number of killed, really that's what it's looking at, because we really don't have a good idea on just how many died. But killed, there's a lot more information, as you would expect, between memorials, between 1560s, between other things and other things that you see. Again, we're looking at, this was, I think, 11.8% was what we found, and that was between, you have to take out all combat, counterterrorism missions, people who died from accident, homicide, suicide, or natural causes. You end up with 1,861. Number we found. And then you look at the number that were killed, that we say were reconstruction, it comes out to about 11.8%. Again, I think that should be used as a floor. not, I think it's probably more than that, but that's just all we can find. And curiously, since I also worked on the one from Iraq, it also worked out to about 12%. Interestingly enough, it's a little higher for officers. I can't speak for, I'm not speaking for the for cigar at this point, because I'm talking about something I did in a previous job. But the one in Iraq reconstruction was about 25% for officers who died on reconstruction missions. And that would, you could, that's what you'd expect, because the SFAVs, the PMTs, all the training of the Iraqi Afghans is officer heavy. And that's what the majority of those casualties was.
Great questions from Hal. Thank you. So who is USACE doing the work for? So downrange, there are three primary agencies that the Corps of Engineers works with daily to execute the program. The first and largest is the Combined Security Transition Assistance Command Afghanistan. We call them CSTICA for short. That's Congressional Appropriation from the U.S. government. We work on behalf of U.S. Forces Afghanistan. We did early on a lot of MILCON work, Commander's Emergency Response Program work, and General OMA appropriation. And we are currently executing work on behalf of the U.S. Agency for International Development, which is a different type of funding stream. That's what we're completing, the electrical infrastructure, that type of money for that agency. There's an emerging portfolio with NATO, since NATO has an obviously continuing presence there. Right now, the Corps of Engineers is exploring how to work with NATO, because the funding doesn't come through the traditional U.S. government ways. Challenges as to the labor pools. So initially, when the program was double, triple, quadruple what it is now, it was much easier from a contracting perspective to get large-scale international firms to work in Afghanistan. And depending on who those international firms were, they contracted with host nation professionals who lived outside of Afghanistan or Afghans themselves. As the portfolio has drawn down, generally speaking, most of the workers are Afghan. That comes with a ton of positives in that USACE has been very key to actually developing engineer capacity and technical capacity in the country. We call the Afghans that work on contract with the Corps local national quality assurance professionals, and some of them have gone on to own companies that do contract work with USACE. And then, of course, they own those companies that employ the Afghans. I would say, obviously, the biggest challenge with the labor pools is the technical competency of the professionals. However, based on the universities available in country and then where some Afghans have gone to school, some of them come back from the United States to Afghanistan, considering all the unrest, the strife, all the stress that's happened, they are very, very good at what they do. But I would say their qualification and technical competency would absolutely be probably the biggest challenge. And I think that's probably the answer to the
question. Sir, I'm just going to stick there in that last question. So did we develop too quickly? I think most of you can imagine that I would say absolutely, we did. There was this period of time where I just got comfortable with, there's like the right answer, the 100% solution, and then there was like Afghan good enough, and that's not a derogatory thing. It was, we realized our expectations, what we were aiming for had to be different. We weren't going to create miniature United States all over the globe, right? Like it's just not a thing. We all start in a different place. We all have different backgrounds and different historical baggage, all sorts of things. So I think we just continue to relearn this. We can't transplant our ideas. And when you do, you lose legitimacy. So you wouldn't want to, in the first place, export your ideas, because immediately they're going to be seen as foreign and outside ideas. These kinds of things have to come with within, come from within, and that certainly takes time. One of the key problems to this is that our political system is designed with very short kind of attention span, I suppose you could say, right? And even militarily, not just looking at our political design, but our commands. They last 2 years and they rotate out, or deployments, they're year-long deployments. Where is the experience, that stays from a specific area? When you look at Afghanistan, you're looking at a multi-generational, at least a single generation
conflict in order to change ideas. And you have to be willing to actually see down that entire 30 years of development. And I just don't know that we went in with that picture. And it's, of course, it's very difficult when you're in a system that is only designed to make that quick win, right? Another kind of insight is that Kabul is not equal to the state, right? Like, Kabul is a very small area, very different. Afghanistan is a rather big country. Where I was in Kunar province was like being in Appalachia. You know, we're talking to mountain men and women, and I remember being told once when I was trying to pay someone to clean off the road that we had built in front of their area, and he asked me why I thought that I could go onto that road and give out permission to have it cleaned, because it was his road. So no concept of like government ownership, like I own this road, it's in front of my house. Yeah, you know, this little strip. And that's something that I never would have thought of, the whole different way of thinking and perceiving. I had to get out of my, you know, my box there. And then the other one was the perception that who is the government? The government has money, that's what they do, right? They either shower us with money or they don't, and if they don't, then you know, they're jerks and the government's not doing its job. Because not the entire nation of Afghanistan is down with the central government concept. So this is it's a much larger problem. And we tried to jump from, okay, we started the war, and now let's insert some of these very advanced kind of ideas and programs, because we want to wrap it up real quick, you know, get our mission accomplished, picture and drive on. It's not working out really.
How about that? Turn it over to you all. Questions you want to know about Reconstruction? We have three different perspectives up here. You got it.
Start off. My name is Ben tonight. Coming out. I'm looking forward. So this is for you. This is Silence. The U.S. obviously does both reconstruction projects and Afghanistan as well as around the world. Can you talk a little about the difference between the projects in Mongolia, the PACOM, SOUTHCOM, all those different regions compared to combat zones of Afghanistan? And secondly, assessment of that. Is that anything that you say it does? Or is that all in other agencies, USAID, to assess how these projects are actually useful or not?
So I can't really comment on reconstruction outside of Afghanistan. I've worked CONUS and I've worked in Afghanistan. What I can say is no matter where USAID is constructing, there may be a few exceptions. Department of Defense, USAID, or another government agency would ask USAID to do that work. So in that respect, it's all very similar. You just will never have USAID show up in a country, no matter if it's a war zone or not, and say, we're going to start building. That just won't happen, at least I don't think in my lifetime. So in that way, it's very similar. I think the assessment is probably one of the crucial questions for discussion today, and I think SIGAR has written a lot about that, because if an agency requests USAID to construct all of those bases that we did around the country for the Defense Security Forces, is it up to USAID to decide whether that was successful, or whether we should have done it in the first place? And I cannot speak to that. That wouldn't even be my role. From the engineer perspective, we can assess whether we built the installation according to the plans and specs. That's really pretty easy. I mean, I don't want to. It's hard from an engineering perspective, but in the larger scheme of things, that's the job for USAID. I think what's tripped many agencies up, including Department of Defense, is that assessment piece. My first job was to build two power plants in Kandahar to run on diesel generation in 2010 to turn the lights on in Kandahar when the surge happened. And of course, those were the days of the counterinsurgency strategy, so very different from what we're doing now. And those two power plants went up on time and in on budget. You don't want to know what the budget was, but we got them done. And there was a long O&M tail, which had to do with diesel fuel and how it got to those plants. And you can imagine the logistical and financial impacts that had. So who should assess whether I did my job correctly? Yes, from a project management standpoint, they were on time and on budget. The fact that those power plants aren't running right now for a variety of reasons, who's to assess whether it had the correct effect that the military commanders were looking for. So it doesn't answer your question, but I think those are the types of questions you have to keep asking if you as military leaders decide to use reconstruction as a military tool, no matter what kind of funding you use, is how are you going to assess if it's correct?
Okay, so I'll make a plug for Cigar at this point.
I wasn't making it.
No, you weren't. You're good. We do a lot of assessments, a lot of audits, and we try to answer that question for a lot of these big ticket items. Some smaller ticket items, and one, was it worth it? Did we get value? One of the interesting things about this Special Inspector General, the reason it's a Special Inspector General is because it doesn't just focus on the Department of Defense or U.S. Agency for Energy Development, our Department of State focuses on anything that we spent on reconstruction. So we take a broader look, and we do look at that. What was the plan? What was the need? What was the outcome? And what was the assessment on what it was done, like on electrical projects? Did power actually flow through it? And does it actually provide power for everybody? That's the kind of things that we answer. And it's a mixed bag, and a lot of these, as you can expect. If you go to the website, there's way too much. We've done hundreds of these different types of things. If there's anything you want to know about what value we got out of reconstruction, we write a quarterly report. We have to do by congressional mandate. It's published every quarter, as you expect, at the end of every quarter, and it's got all kinds of information on what we did. Really, leave it up to you to decide when you look at these reports and you look at what we're saying on how well we spent the money, would be over $100 billion we spent on reconstruction. We have to look at with what this peace deal made, what's going to be the future, what are we going to be doing next? And I don't know what the answer to that. That's not the main question.
Next question.
Major Walker, you brought up a discussion of how we might have some issues with sort of discontinuity and long-term conflicts. So what are some things that the Army is already doing, or some things that you might recommend the Army do to work on this problem?
All right, I'm going to buy time for you. So what can the Army do, or what is the Army doing? So I'll be honest, I don't know of anything that the Army is currently doing and trying to look at the time horizons of the problem solving. I know that, at least in my limited career, I did see my brigade that deployed to Kunar in that specific area, their next deployment to Afghanistan, was to that exact same area. So that was at least nice. There was some institutional knowledge with some of the soldiers and some of the old products and things like that. But as you know, we still lost a lot of leadership. There's still a lot of turnover. So that's not exactly a great solution either. The military is always going to suffer from it. Where we may see gains, or where we may see some kind of solution, is going to be where there's less rotation. And that's got to be, in my opinion, come from USAID or from the State Department, where we have folks that specialize in a specific area, and they are the experts, and we should defer to them on these kind of reconstruction things. Like, we shouldn't forget that while this is a piece of what the Army is being told to do under MPO, the Army still isn't designed to necessarily do all of this, right? Fight and win the nation's wars, kind of limited scope. In general, we lack the expertise to do assessment. This is stuff that is done by PhD economists and still very difficult to do. What we do have is we have access. We are in the right place at the right time in the non-permissive environment. We can ask the questions. But we don't necessarily have the capacity to answer those questions and to assess them properly. So maybe in the future, as we're kind of looking at future things the Army could do, is some kind of partnering between the U.S. government, maybe academia, so we have the same minds with access to the same data that may be able to get those kind of longitudinal assessments, and maybe even help in crafting the question. Wouldn't that be nice? If you had an academic who's studying this area or this region and becomes an expert in this kind of intervention, whether it be agriculture or what have you, and they can tell the people on the front line, ask this question, do this survey thing, or try this, and we test it out, and they give us the result. So I think that maybe that's the future, is we realize that given our constraints, we won't be better at assessment in some of these, nor should we, but we can partner to gain that kind of expertise.
Sure. So before I answer the question, I just want to comment on reconstruction as during conflict and post-conflict. So in my mind, those are two very different things, and certainly USAID approaches it as reconstruction at any stage of the game, right? So to answer that question, I think makes it harder, because if you are constructing during COIN, for example, which is the strategy I was very familiar with in the beginning of my tenure down there, the continuity to that strategy is going to be different than if the strategy changes all of a sudden, and then you are reconstructing or constructing during a different strategy. And that's a really, I don't know how better to explain that, but what continuity do you need if the strategy changes? So I think you have to make sure you know what continuity you're talking about. What I can say is the three major portfolios that I'm most familiar with, and I think that are the biggest in the country, the first being constructing all those military installations that we're still building over there, because construction takes a long time, which goes to continuity, right? The power, the electrical infrastructure takes a very, very long time, and the work on the bases, major bases or U.S. bases. In that sense, the continuity hasn't changed. I mean, the approach hasn't changed, even though the strategy, the military strategy, so there's a lot of goodness that comes out of those three portfolios. We are finishing them. I say we, you say, but I'm also talking about the people that paid us to do that work. We're finishing a lot of that work that started way, way back in 2002, even though the military strategy changed. So engineering organizations in particular, I think, provide great continuity, because when a command comes in and wants to change a construction project, obviously, the engineering organization is the best place to talk about the pros and cons of doing so. So you can rely on other organizations in the theater to help provide that continuity of strategy. And sometimes they are canceled projects based on the command's current perspective on the conflict or the local conflict. Didn't really answer your question, but something to think about.
All right, first I'm gonna talk about some things that Cigar's done now that my own personal opinion. So that has been a major problem on continuity, and that's one of the things that's been highlighted that you have. You've heard it said in various ways that we didn't have an 18-year deployment, we had 18 one-year deployments. And every new commander comes in and he has a better idea about how to do that, so he cancels other projects and no longer sees that. Meanwhile, the Corps or whoever else has already started to work on these things and they can't just stop. They've already run the contract that they need to deploy. My own personal experience, what has the Army done? And I'll back up a little bit. I think one of the provincial reconstruction teams that were created, I saw before we had them and then after in Iraq, and I thought that at least now we knew what the other guys were doing, what the other portions of government was doing. I now had visibility on what USA projects were doing. I now had visibility on what the Department of State saw for developing the local governments. That was helpful. Whether or not we coordinated or did anything with them is another story, but the other thing I think the Army's done well, again, DOD writ large, is the creation of the SFABs. So now you have a little bit of continuity, at least in the development of the ANDSF, Afghan National Defense and Security Forces. You have some continuity in how the development is going long term. Before, if you look at previously, those were more ad hoc, teams thrown together. They receive a little bit of training, but they may not ever work together, and they get when they were sent out. Now, their whole function is that, their security, everything with a commander and leader. I think we'll see how, we just started this recently. I think they're only on the third SFAB deploy. I may be mistaken, but I think they're on the third now. And so we'll see what the benefits are. Now, to me, that was important.
Thank you all for coming. I'm also Dan Phillips, so I have to ask my sister. So my question is very short, but I have a pretty lengthy explanation for the question. So some of us are in SS-486 here, so for our guests, that's a state building class. And we talked about the different approaches to state building. So whether it be multi-tracked approach to state building, where you focus on a bunch of different things, or extended sequence, like you talked about in the world. And in the Army's defense, they had never done really anything like state building in a very long time, so 2002. No one handed them a how-to state build document, and so thanks for your work, but no one handed them the human cost of reconstruction. In the class, we read Charles Tilly, who's a political scientist, who talked about state formation and state building. And if it were up to him, the real reconstruction would be starting on Sunday, after a peace agreement, after there's no bullets being fired, and there's security established for the area. So my question for the panelists is, in your own opinion, do you believe in a more multi-tracked approach to state building, or focusing on securing the area, setting up all these different institutions, or a sequence? I know later on you talked about the Army having a short attention span, which would kind of allude, in my opinion, to more of a sequence approach, where we establish a very safe, secure area, and then we set up, you know, all these different institutions. So.
I'll start. This is my opinion. I'm looking at it at John Ranger and seeing the different organizations. I really like the approach you talk about, sequential. Because I don't think the Army just has the expertise to do to get into economic development. You may have one or two guys, a handful of military, but overall as an Army, that's really not something we should be doing right off the bat. Alleviating suffering, we can do that providing security for the people who are doing it, and then at some point, I don't know, there's some type of decision point where you shift into the different organizations. We really didn't have that plan at all going into Iraq or Afghanistan. We kind of working on the fly. It reminds me of, we interviewed when I was a Special Inspector General for Iraq Reconstruction. We interviewed a Corps General, as a matter of fact, in Iraq. And we asked him, why did you take on all these different reconstruction aspects? And he just said that, look, we found they were failing. We have a leadership. And then he kind of paused and he said, you know, when we see a leader, we're in the Army. When we see a leadership vacuum, we fill it. And he was right. But should we fill it? Why are we doing this stuff that we don't, that we really have? That we just thought someone's good idea and we just drove on with it, whether we didn't have an overarching plan. And then we find ourselves later on in kind of in trouble. So again, to answer your question, I think it should be sequential with a series of decision points on when, and at some point, if you look at Syria, I'm setting this example right now. Humanitarian problems, Northern Iraq, Mosul, humanitarian problems, you try to solve them and you try to rebuild. Well, who should be doing that? I hope that there's somewhere out there they've got some decision points on their house. The guys on the ground, remember, you can't do that. That needs to go to someone else. That's right.
So I think it's great that we're teaching state building. I'll just say that. I think that is a conversation that needs to keep happening. So kudos to the leadership here at West Point for continuing that. I would say reconstruction has to be phased, but absolutely I don't think it can wait, at least in the current environment, until post-conflict. I think the lines have blurred between what conflict and post-conflict is in some ways. That's a debate for another day probably, but I look, at least in Afghanistan, the military chose to use reconstruction as a tool in conflict, right? That, I'll just go back to those power plants. Our goal was to turn the lights on in Kandahar so that the NATO could show a win in light of the Taliban or the insurgents. So I think it has to be phased, but I don't think there's going to be the luxury, weird word to use, to wait until post-conflict any longer. I think, had we not started building those Afghan National Security Defense installations 20 years ago, they wouldn't have them now. And any hope, knock on wood, of a peace deal, I hope those installations are going to be used for the good of that. How else would they defend? Now some could say, well, why are you teaching them our defense, right? Maybe they should have had them to begin with. Yeah, that's another conversation. But I don't think you can wait until everything is done, the agreements are signed, and say, okay, now we're going to start reconstruction. Certainly in Afghanistan, that hasn't been the case, so I think it's a very interesting case study, whereas the Germany, the Marshall Plan, is kind of a different case.
Thank you. So, you know, I did say sequential. So yeah, I do believe sequential, but I don't want to be mistaken in that, yes, we do this in sequence, but across a whole bunch of different sectors, right? Like, I have come to really appreciate the idea of money as a weapon system. And I firmly believe that we could spend a dollar on a bullet, you know, or spend another dollar on an aid project. The jury is out as to the efficacy, right? Because these are hard things to study, especially in conflict. Part of the problem with assessment, by the way, bleeds over into all the infrastructure projects that we've had, is you make this giant investment in this giant road or this big power plant. You just made a symbol of government legitimacy, right? You think your enemy likes that? No, they're going to shoot at it. They're going to attack the people that are building it, right? And when they do that, now you have a simple correlation of, well, I made a big project and violence went up. And if you don't understand data and you don't understand assessments, you go, okay, well, big projects are bad. We should not do this, right? But that's, we don't know how to do assessment very well here. We need help. I think that the things like ASCOPE and PEMISI and all these other ways that we do assessments, we can't forget those. Those were good lessons that we learned, that a populace is many faceted, right? And I'm looking at, you know, winning a war is one thing. Establishing a peace is another thing. It requires a relationship. We got to build those relationships, even though we're having personnel turnover, right, which makes it super hard to have a relationship. But to build those relationships, you need to target every area of their life and do these kinds of interventions. So I struggle with the idea of CCTs. I've actually seen them, conditional cash transfers in country, in theater, where we would go to the village elder and be like, hey man, nobody shoots at us this next week, I'll give you a prize, you know, like I'll build you a thing. It sounds right, you know, oh, incentives matter, except, well, what happens when the enemy finds out that that's a thing? You think they're just gonna sit on the sideline? No, they're absolutely going to launch an attack, disrupt that, and now the populace doesn't get this, you know, benefit, and you don't grow closer to the populace in this, you know, you're denied it. The other option on the other end of the perspective, or on the other end of the spectrum, rather, is that the village elder cuts a deal with the enemy, and nobody shoots for exactly 1 month. They split, you know, whatever the reward was, and then conflict starts up again, right? So this is incredibly complex to do these both simultaneously. This is the kind of stuff that you're going to face. There are truly no easy answer. My last thing that I wanted to talk about with assessment, just because we brought it up, just because you can measure it, doesn't mean we should. And just because we can measure it, doesn't make it the correct measurement, right? Like we all know, body count doesn't necessarily mean you're winning, but we sure like to count something. You know, I'm looking for any data that can prove that I'm achieving something. But we struggle to really identify the right indicator. What is success? What's an indicator of that success? I got to get that right, or else I can't really know with any certainty whether we're doing good or not, right? But deep down, the Duncan Walker opinion is I fundamentally believe that a good eventually. Very hard to measure and all that, but just on the surface, even if it doesn't give you these great impacts in the future, I don't think that it does harm. That's a conversation for another time.
Other questions? Thanks again for coming and speaking with us. My question stems from a quote from the Office of Reconstruction and Humanitarian Assistance shortly after we entered Iraq. That being George Marshall started in 1942 working on a 1945 problem. We're starting in February working on what's probably a March or April problem. And so my question is, what exactly is, or who has the responsibility and the legal authority to plan and coordinate reconstruction efforts from the U.S. side? And what role does the host nation play in both like the short and long-term planning of reconstruction efforts?
An easy one.
I will turn this over to someone who knows the exact answer to that. What I can tell you from the USAID's perspective is that we got a lot of our direction and coordination through CENTCOM. So from the DOD side, it would come from a co-commerce CCD. But I don't want to speculate beyond that. I mean, ideally, there is interagency, to go to the Colonel Howell's area of expertise, that decides those questions, but I'll leave it at that.
Okay, yeah, sure. Let me sort of answer that by giving you a slightly different answer to your previous question. You've probably heard the term lessons learned before. Well, the Army's actually not very good at lessons learned. I should say the government's not. We're very good at writing down lessons, and putting them somewhere, and forgetting we had them, and then relearning them all again. So we're good at taking lessons or noting down lessons. Because in Afghanistan, as a case, we have an example of, to go back to sequencing, other research into reconstruction type activities, security won't bring about a better outcome. Security is a necessary function. If we don't provide security, we can't do any of the other projects that will be economic development or political development or human capital development, which are all done normally by agencies that don't wear uniforms, by other civilian agencies. So we have to have the security for sequence. We have to have the security in order to do the other things. The challenge is all those other activities are done by people that aren't in the military. So now we have a synchronization problem where every agency does their own thing on their own way, and it's not synchronized. And that's not a new problem. Afghanistan is America's longest war, America's second longest war in Vietnam. That's the exact same problem they had then when they were trying to do the pacification program. So unfortunately, you hit it on the nail on the head. We're relearning the same problem that we learned in the late 60s. We said, well, we'll never make this mistake again. And we did. So the fact that we're sort of tapping in on who has the authority, that might be an indicator that it's not very clear, which means, you know, the military could be saying, well, maybe we're in charge of security, but someone else is doing that. And now we have an interagency synchronization problem because that's just the nature of government. So I'm going to study something forever, bang your head against the wall, study interagency stuff. Any comments? Or we've got big time for one more.
Sir, I'd like to give you a comment.
I just want to talk about planning for reconstruction. Right, like we plan for going in and invading just about every country, right? Like there's no plan for everything. Why isn't there a reconstruction plan? Yeah, you know, like if I plan on blowing this bridge as a part of the Oak Plan, there's nothing that says I could not, I don't know, allocate some resources to how we're going to repair stuff in the future. So I think, you know, the Iraq where it's like, all right, we did it. Now it's phase four, you know. Now what? Well, we don't really have a plan. So planning better, and I will take a crack on the who's responsible within kind of the lens that I gave you, the framework of, look, we've got stability, we've got economic development, we have growth. There are three different ends. I would say that the Army is primarily concerned with stability. I would say that USAID can cover down on economic development. And if you really want growth, which takes changing institutions, right, political institutions, then that's the job of the State Department. And of course, all these are involved, right? But it seems like those line up in kind of a logical order.
Any last burning question?
Sorry, that's good. So in terms of the question of Army Nation, maybe you suggested, obviously then we say who does it, USAID, State Department. The big problem that stands out in my head is that they're not really funded very well generally. And two, do they even know what to do? In terms of the first question, I think the second question, I don't know what we're going to do about that. Economists keep working on it. But for the first question, is there a role where maybe the US Army should step up and take over some of these roles just because we're getting the funding for it? Dr. Burnett, I think, gave a talk at the talk I watched like a second and a half ago talking about creating like a new part of the military that was in charge of these stability operations. We already have civil affairs, we have different organizations in the Army that are more on this side of things. Is it good to grow that, or should we try to stick to this traditional role of Army, USA, State?
Thank you. I can talk my personal opinion again, but I think it needs to be divided. We need to do a little bit, but I think if we act like we're going to take it all, we're going to take it all. And then there'll be no room for USA and the Department of State to do anything. I think that's kind of what we've done in Afghanistan and Iraq. I mean, there was, the stories are legion. I was part of this when I was there, but we had money burning a hole in our pocket. We were gonna spend money no matter what, and it didn't. And we began looking at learning as a weapon system. It wasn't just what the outcome was, it was how much we spent and how many projects were completed. I gave a briefing on this to back in 2011 2010 in Fort Bend, and I had one soldier standing by, and he said, I agree with everything you said in your presentation except for one thing. It's not that they're not counting the number of projects we complete, they're counting the number of projects we start. So he was that cynical. He didn't even think it mattered if we completed. So that's what I feared. So we ended up starting down this road. And how I started getting into this initially was because we don't know what we've got. We don't know what we fully grasp. We're not the experts yet. We come in and have appointments. When I was in one district in the middle of Baghdad, I found that I was the third person to refurbish schools. And every time it went up exponentially. So at first time, the first refurbished school, someone tried 3 years earlier, was in the hundreds, but the second guy was in the thousands by the time we got to him, was in the hundreds of thousands. And that's, we just can't be doing that. It's a waste of money, it's a waste of our time. We don't know what we're getting out of it. So I don't think we need to let the experts come in and do what they need to do. And we need to do some alleviation, some things that within our grasp to do. But if we try to grab too much, we can.
I think my perspective is I'm in full support of interagency. Quite honestly, I've never served in Iraq, but I think the Iraq approach might have been a little more coordinated than what Afghanistan is experiencing. But I think there is a huge role for both state and DOD in the same room, deciding what reconstruction should happen when, and then let the funding fall out of whatever the strategy is first, rather than let the funding drive the strategy. And I think sometimes that's what we do. But I think it has to be interagency, and then it depends on the military strategy and the transfer to civil authorities after that.
So I'm not going to give you the who should lead it. I'm just going to go around it completely. I'm going to give you an idea of how we could do a little better now. Like if you were actually trying to crack that nut and make the Army better at it, I'd say the ORSA usage. I think we probably underutilize folks that know how to do real assessment in the Army. And then I would look at National Guard and Reserve soldiers, right? So folks that have a completely other civilian life and who have these great skills, folks that already run things at the municipal level, or maybe they're expert electricians. A world of talent out there, right, that we could leverage. Maybe you have your active duty forces take care of the beginning, an invasion, that kind of threat reduction to achieve stability. But then when you're starting to look at how do we run a country, maybe we need people that do something else in their normal life, right, that they can rely on. Maybe there's an opportunity, given how many people we have in this Army, to check those qualifications and build temporary units that could assist in development. Not that we should, but just saying, I had to figure it out.
We add on to Duncan's thought, and then we'll probably wrap this up. To say Duncan's thought is completely not original, in the sense that during World War II, this goes back to the lessons written down but not lessons learned. During World War II, the U.S. military, the U.S. government did a very good job of planning on reconstruction. They had what we call military government units. And what these units were filled with, they were filled with officers and senior NCOs. And here's how they found them. They said, we need expertise on how to run schools, how to run police, how to run power grids, how to run governments, how to run an economy. And they went to the U.S., they went to state, local governments, and the industry, and said, congratulations, you're now a specialized officer. Here's your uniform, here's how you salute. And so the Army did it, but they didn't do it with Army skill sets. They went out and found every skill set they needed. And they put a uniform on and said, now you're going to do reconstruction. So it was really taking civilian expertise and putting a uniform on it, which sounds actually very similar to the concept you have. So with that, we're about out of time, so please give me a round of applause for that. We'll be up front if you have more questions.